We obviously have a serious problem on our hands, and it's something that I've been talking about for quite a few years. And earlier on, the senator brought up the subject of the depression, and you did allude to the fact that dislocations and credit creations are a problem and can add fuel to this fire. But at times, I don't think you follow those rules very well. I mean, even though you recognize that's the case, because I think understanding the depression is one of our problems, or the lack of understanding of the depression, because generally most of what people are taught these days is that it was a lack of credit in the 30s that caused the prolongation of the depression. They never talk about the excessive credit and the misallocation and the malinvestment of the 20s that precipitated the bubble that had to be corrected. And then in the depression, what did we try to do? We tried to fix prices, which is exactly what we're doing now. We would not, in the depression, allow wages to go down, and we said, well, the price of farm products has to stay up. So in doing that, we plowed crops under, and people were starving. And I don't think we've gained a whole lot of wisdom since we were plowing under crops to keep prices up. Because now we're talking about illiquid assets. And we're talking about price fixing. And we're talking about somebody in the government, in the Federal Reserve and Treasury, who does prices. Now, the Austrian School of Economics, which has been around a long time, they predicted the Depression, they predicted the 1970s, the breakdown of Bretton Woods, they predicted all that's happening today. Their key point is, don't mess around with prices. Because if you do, you become socialistic. And this is why Mises predicted the failure of socialism and why it did fail. But here we are in price fixing again. You say that part of your mandate is price stability, but I hardly think price stability comes by price fixing. But the idea of you taking an illiquid asset, for the most part, most illiquid assets are illiquid because they're not worth anything. And if somebody has a house that they bought for $4 million, it goes up to $5 million, he wants to sell and nobody buys it, that's really not an illiquid asset. If he takes it down to one, he might sell it. But people aren't smart enough. The Federal Reserve is not smart enough. Treasury is not smart enough. Congress is not smart enough to know what prices are. So I think that is the greatest danger of what we're doing here is we're price fixing. And that is what I'm convinced that prolonged the depression in the 1930s because we got into that. And this whole idea of credit creation, we've already created $700 billion worth of credit because of the interference and the involvement in the markets rating. And here we're coming along with another $700 billion. The real question is, where does it come from? And we're surely not going to tax the economy $700 billion. No way would even consider this. But are we going to borrow it? Well, we could go to our bankers, our friends in China. They might come up with $700 billion loaned to us, but I doubt it. But where are they going to come? They're going to come to you. They're going to come to you to create credit. But I don't even know where you get the authority to create credit out of thin air. There's certainly no authority in the Constitution for you to have endless authority to create money and credit out of thin air, which is a basic problem that we have. This is why we're here today, is that we haven't understood that. And all the blame is put on the fact that there is a downturn in housing. Well, that means they were overpriced. So all our efforts right now is to keep the prices up. But the prices should come down. That's what the market is saying. But to fix prices at a higher level than they should be, I think just compounds our problem. But, you know, I would like to just see if I can get an opinion from you on where all this authority comes from. My estimation now is there's probably only about 15% of the people in this country who really care about the Constitution and the law, the rule of law. And sometimes I think there are less here in Washington. But where does this authority come from for this unlimited amount of money? Why not at least the $700 billion being appropriated but on this new, but the other isn't? But you're going to have to monetize a bunch of this. And quite frankly, I'd have trouble finding anything in the Constitution that said, this is it. You know, this particular paragraph says, the Congress has the right to buy up illiquid assets. Could you comment on this authority and the basic fundamentals of when we're going to address this? If we don't, we can't solve the problem of inflation with more inflation.
Thank you, Congressman. First of all, I actually agree with you about the price fixing in the Depression. I think there's a pretty wide consensus that the National Recovery Act and the setting of fixing of wages and prices was a counterproductive step, and I agree with you there. On the whether prices are being fixed for these securities, the intention is to use market-based mechanisms, auctions and other things, to try to discover what the true prices are, or at least something approximating a market price. It's not going to be price setting in that respect, as I understand it. I would note about the Depression that one has to balance concerns about intervening in financial markets with concerns about macroeconomic stability. In the case of the Depression, the Federal Reserve essentially took no action as the banking system collapsed. About a third of the banks in the country failed. Fed, following the advice of Secretary Mellon, liquidated the banks, liquidated labor, and so on, and that didn't work out so well. With respect to your other questions, I want to respond also again to Vice Chair Maloney. There's no need for the Federal Reserve to monetize any of this borrowing. The Federal Reserve has an independent instrument, its management of monetary policy. I do not expect additional inflationary consequences from this. As to our authority, of course, the Constitution gives the Congress the right to coin money and regulate the value thereof.
Coins.
And that has been delegated to the Federal Reserve through the Federal Reserve Act, and everything we've done is directly based on that act. Now, if you disagree with the act, that's a different issue, but we certainly have the authority from Congress.
Klobuchar.
Thank you very